Good morning and welcome to Southern Hills this morning. We do want to extend a special welcome to all of our guests and visitors this morning, as well as those of you joining us via live stream this morning. If you are visiting with us and have not stopped back by the Welcome Center, I encourage you to stop back by there at some point this morning. I hope everyone's had a chance to pick up one of our bulletins. If not, there's still plenty of copies left back in the back foyer. But just a few announcements we'd like to make, an update to our sick and shut-in list. Mary Nell Hogg was moved to NHC Place in Cool Springs on Tuesday, and she continues to improve. She does appreciate visits and calls from everyone. So if you have just a minute, if you could give her a call and just check on her. Also, Mike Weiss, Bob and Carol Terry's son-in-law, is in the Mayo Clinic in Florida after suffering a stroke on Tuesday. Bob did call me this morning, and Mike is doing much better. He's recovering from the stroke very nicely, does have some residual effects from it, but he is doing much better. Also want to remember Donovan Holt. She'll be having a biopsy done this coming up week. Also, Beverly Smithson is in the hospital with high blood sugar. She was admitted yesterday. She is hoping to go home today sometime. We do want to extend our sympathy to the Koss family on the passing of Brother Clarence, who passed away Thursday morning. A visitation and the funeral will both be today at Spring Hill Memorial Park in Spring Hill. Visitation will begin at noon and the service will begin at 2 p.m. That being said, our babysitting that our youth group was going to provide today is being postponed till next Sunday afternoon. So next Sunday afternoon, December the 4th, our youth group will be here at the building to provide free babysitting for those of you who would like to get a head start on your holiday decorating or shopping. Also, Saturday, December the 3rd, anyone who is available and like to help hand out coats to some children in Franklin, we're asking that you meet here at the building at 1:30. We'll head over to the areas where we will hand out coats. We plan to be back here at the building by 2 to 2:30 back here at the building in time for a chant about 3:30. If you have any questions, you can see me or John Cottrell in getting set up for that. But those are the announcements that I have for this morning. If you would bow with me in prayer as we begin. Father in heaven, we are thankful for your word. We are thankful for the time last week that we were able to stop and spend time with our families and focus on the things that we are most thankful for. Father, we are thankful for your son. We are thankful for his willingness to come and die on the cross so that we can have a home with you in heaven one day. Father, we pray that as we gather around your throne and worship your name, that you be with each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first song this morning is number 350.
Thank you.
next song is number 571. Scripture and prayer, we'll sing number 68.
This morning's scripture reading comes from Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verses 32 through 40. Again, that is Hebrews 11, 32 through 40. And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they may obtain a better resurrection. Still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, were tempted, were slain with a sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and caves of the earth. And all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us.
Let's go ahead and pray. Our God and our Father in heaven, we thank you for blessing us with this Lord's Day. We're thankful for this absolutely gorgeous weather. We're thankful for this opportunity we have to gather here and worship you and bow before you and acknowledge your greatness and goodness. Father, you are an amazing being, omniscient, omnipotent, all present at all times at once, full of love and grace and mercy, but also righteous and just and pure. We acknowledge you for your greatness and your goodness and your perfection in every single dimension. Father, we have many that are dealing with acute health concerns, and we lay them before you this morning. We pray a prayer of thanksgiving that Mary Nell is feeling some better. We pray a prayer of thanksgiving that Mike is recovering from his stroke from earlier this week. We pray that Donavine and her biopsy go well later this week. We also pray for Beverly, that she would recover from her ailment. Father, we pray our hearts break for the Cost family. Father, we know that Brother Clarence was faithful, and Father, that does not make it easier for the Costs and those that were especially close to Brother Clarence. Father, we pray that you be with them and that you help them emotionally and spiritually through this time of grieving. Father, we thank you so much for Southern Hills. We're thankful for this congregation and the love that we have for one another. Father, we pray that you would help fill our hearts with even more love and faithfulness, that we would be servant-minded, that we would look to those who have needs and meet those needs, whether they be physical or spiritual or emotional, that we would lend a helping hand, that would be evangelistic to our community, that would be encouragers to each other, that we'd build each other up. Father, our country seems to be going down a strange and dark direction, and Father, we pray for a great awakening. We pray that souls would turn to you wholesale, and that as your church, that we would be ready to meet them and show the way to Jesus. Father, we're so grateful for every spiritual blessing that you've made available in him, and we're so excited about the news of him, and we'd like to share this message with others, and we pray that you give us boldness, but also at the same time give us patience and tactfulness as we engage our neighbors and our coworkers and our families. We know that that's the only way that we can turn this country's culture back towards you is through our evangelistic efforts and our benevolent efforts. Father, we await heaven. We so yearn to be with you for all of eternity so that you could take away all of this pain, all of the tears, that we would live in your joyful presence for all of eternity, for every single day. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper. We'll sing In Christ Alone.
In Christ alone, my In a few moments, we'll be gathered around this table to partake of the Lord's Supper. I would like to read a few verses before doing that. I'll be reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse 13, reading through verse 21. Now, we'll be reading from the English Standard Version. Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on him as Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. We're going to bow and offer a blessing for the bread that represents his body that was given for us. Would you bow with me, please? Our dear Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before thee. We thank thee for this bread. We thank thee for the body that it represents. We thank thee for giving the gift of your Son that we could offer as a sacrifice for our sins. We ask thy blessings upon it, and we offer this prayer through his name. Amen. Would you bow with me again, please? Dear Father, once again, we bow before thee. We thank thee for the fruit of the vine that represents the blood of your Son, the blood that was shed for redemption for our sins. We ask thy blessings upon us as we partake of it, and we offer this prayer through his name. Amen. This concludes the Lord's Supper. At this time, the elders have set aside as an appropriate time for us to partake and offer the contributions that support our church and fulfill our Christian duties for that. We do have mention on the board if you would like to give through the internet. If you would, please bow with me, please. Our dear Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before thee once again. We're very grateful for the wonderful things that you give to us. We realize that we live in a country that's very blessed. We live in a region and an area that's richly blessed. And everything we have comes from thee. We're very grateful for shining your light upon us and allowing us to prosper. We ask thy blessings upon those as we give back that which already belongs to you. We're very grateful for your son and very grateful for his sacrifice. And we offer this prayer in his name. Amen.
Before our lesson this morning, let's stand and sing number 351.
With you, I would encourage you to open up to that passage, Mark chapter 10. We're going to study verses 35 through 45 of this chapter. It is that time of year, I guess, where a lot in our world who don't typically think about Jesus are thinking about Jesus. I always have somewhat mixed emotions about that. In part, I enjoy it. I think it's a good thing to think about Jesus. And if we can celebrate a time where more people have Jesus on their mind, I think to a degree that's a fine thing and a good thing. I am concerned that there's a lot of things that people think about Jesus throughout this time of year that is not accurate, right? And so I do think that it's a time where we need to, as always, have Jesus on our mind, but also be maybe more attuned to the things that Scripture teaches about him and about his coming. What I want to do today and for the next several weeks is talk about some passages where Jesus specifically said, "This is why I came." Because the Bible tells us, like why did Jesus come to earth? And some people have an okay understanding of it. Some people have a wrong understanding of it. But I want us to have a great understanding of the reason that Jesus came. And I think we can, because Jesus on a number of occasions said, "This is it. This is why I came." And if we will understand that, then we'll have a great understanding of why Jesus came to earth. And what we're going to do today is we're going to look at a conversation that took place between Jesus and his apostles. At first, two brothers, okay? It's a conversation. It begins like this. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." I always thought that's kind of an interesting way to start a conversation, right? I mean, it's an interesting way to start a conversation with anybody, but especially Jesus, where you would have, I don't know, the audacity to come up to him and say, "Okay, we're going to ask you something. We're not going to tell you right now. We kind of just want you to agree to do whatever it is that we ask you to do." Well, Jesus doesn't agree to that. Rather, what Jesus does is he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" Now, there's a very literal way in which we can just pause right here and think, okay, what was going on in James and John's mind? And I think that that's naturally what we're going to do, and we're going to see, like, what is it that they wanted? There's another sense in which you could step back and think, okay, that question could really be asked to any one of us. When you think about Jesus, think about who he is. You think about his capability, his power, his magnificence. What do you want of him? What are you seeking from Jesus? What is it that you think Jesus can do for you, and what is it that you want him to do for you? We'll find out pretty quickly what these men wanted. They said it pretty specifically. It says, and they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one on your left in your glory." See, the apostles understood. And as they came to know Jesus better, you can see this gradual growth in them. From the time when they kind of think of him, well, they describe him here just a moment ago as a teacher. He's a good teacher. Sometimes they would think of him as a prophet. And as you read through the Gospels, you'll see what happened with them is that when they first met Jesus, they were impressed by him. They thought, good teacher. They thought, prophet. They thought, a number of different things like many people in the world thought. And yet, as they got to know Jesus more, as they learned more about Jesus, as they interacted with Jesus more, as they saw him teach and they saw him act and they saw him perform, they grew to understand he's more than just a teacher. Like he's more than even just some worker of miracles or some prophet. I don't know if you remember the conversation that took place. It's pretty well known. It's told to us in Matthew and in Luke and in a number of places in the New Testament where Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And you might remember in Matthew chapter 16, Peter spoke up and he said, well, some say you're Elijah or Jeremiah, John the Baptist or one of the prophets. And Jesus, okay, yeah, that's what the world is saying. And by the way, it's a very kind thing to say about him. I mean, any one of us would be thrilled to be compared to John the Baptist. I'd be thrilled to be compared to Elijah or Jeremiah. But with Jesus, it wasn't enough. And so Jesus asked, okay, but who do you say that I am? And that's when Peter gave that great confession where he said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Like, what happened in the apostles' minds is they started to grow in their appreciation of Jesus. He's not just a teacher. He's not just a prophet. He's not just one of those really good men like Elijah or Jeremiah, godly and holy and people to be respected and held up. He's greater than that. He's the Christ. This is like he's God's chosen king of the world, God's ruler, the one who is to reign, the one who is to be king over all. That's who he is. That's Jesus. And when they started to think about that and started to realize that, there also becomes a transition in like who they are. If he's just a teacher, then they're his students. I mean, disciples, followers of Jesus. Learners of Jesus. The teacher teaches and the students learn. But if he's more, maybe they are also, right? I mean, like if I'm his right-hand man, I'm the one walking with him and I'm the one learning from him. I'm the one going in and out, always with him. Like when you think of the disciples, you can't separate the thought of the disciples with the thought of Jesus. Like what we know about Peter, we only know about Peter because of his relation with Jesus. Like they go hand in hand. And so if he is the king of all, who are we? Well, James and John, who we know well, say, look, we want some of that greatness, right? We want some of that glory. You're the king of glory. You're the king of all. Let us sit at your right hand and at your left hand. Like when people look at you, we want to be in the peripherals, right? Like I want people to look at you, but I kind of want them to see me also. I want to be right there with you. Part of that's a good request, and part of it seems to be missing the point. I want to be associated with Jesus. I want to be right there with Jesus. I want Jesus to be right by me. I want people to associate me with Jesus. I want to be in a sense like that, but on the other sense, there seems to be, and Jesus will point to this, a misunderstanding of what that means. What does it mean to attain the greatness that goes to those who were Jesus's people? King of all the world. What does it mean to be like him? To receive, in a sense, greatness, not his greatness, but greatness that exudes from him, right? Like the greatness that would come to being the right-hand man, sitting on the right or the left of the king of all the world, God's Christ, the Messiah, the one who is this, he'll be called here in a moment, the Son of Man. Daniel 7 paints this picture of the Son of Man coming and destroying the kingdoms of the world and sitting on this throne beside God is kind of like this God-human character that is fascinating and marvelous, and that's Jesus. And what does it mean if I'm his right, on his right hand or his left? Well, Jesus said to them, you do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? I think naturally, Jesus will point this out in a moment, just having lived in this world long enough, we have an understanding of what it means to be the right hand and the left hand man of a king. It means you got a lot of power yourself. It means I'm thinking in my mind, like biblically speaking, like I'm thinking like back in my mind of like, you think of like Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. The Pharaoh of Egypt, right? Powerful, strong, tells people what to do. And then Joseph kind of became, in a sense, like the one who sat on his right hand. And what'd Joseph do? He's powerful. He wore the king's signet ring, right? That he said, you go do this, and people did it. You don't do that, and people, if he wanted to put someone to death, he put someone to death. Like he had this power and this, like just, it's almost, the only one greater in the land is the king. Man, there's a lot of people that Joseph is more powerful than. And like, they're like, okay, well, Jesus is king. What does that mean for me? That means that, I'm really powerful. That I have the right to tell people, go do this, and they will go do this. And tell them, don't do that, and they will not do it. And I'll have power, and I'll have authority. And Jesus says, no, you don't understand. You don't understand what you're asking. You're thinking based upon what you see and what you've experienced. But we'll find out Jesus' kingdom is very much different. Because what's always true is that the right hand, the left hand man of Jesus, like of the king, right? Whether you're on the right hand or the left side, like you have that authority, like you're associated in a sense like a king. So if a king has power, you have power. And the way the king acts, you can kind of act. Right? You can't exercise it over the king, but that's about the only one you can't exercise it over. You have lots and lots of power. Why? Because the king has lots and lots of power. You are like the king. Well, Jesus is going to be different than the kings of the world. And he's asking them, okay, are you ready to be like me? That's the idea, right? If you're thinking because he's king, you'll have power. Well, what if this king is different? Are you willing to be like him here? He says, and he phrases it in this interesting way, to drink the cup that I drink and to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized. And it's this idea of like, when you drink something, it's filled up inside of you. When you're baptized, it's like filled up, immersed outside of you. Like, are you ready to be completely like Jesus? What he does, you do. How he acts, you act. That's what they want, but they don't understand it. They think, I can be like him. Jesus, okay, are you willing to truly be like me? Do you understand what's involved? Can you drink that cup? Can you be baptized into that? Can it fill you up inside? Can you be immersed by it outside? Can it be all around you and consume you completely, being like Jesus? Because you think you want it. Because you think it goes along with sitting on a throne and having power and telling people to do this or that, but you don't understand. And so Jesus goes on, or they go on, they said to him, we are able. And I'm like, I don't know, like there are sometimes like parts of the conversation, I don't know at what point they started to grab what Jesus was saying. But the reality is like, we know a little bit about James and John. And we know that what Jesus is going to talk about is like, he's talking about suffering, and we know that these are not men who were unwilling to suffer. As a matter of fact, you read through the New Testament and you'll find they both would drink the cup that Jesus drank. They both would be baptized with a baptism with which Jesus would baptize, right? They would both suffer. James is killed in, I think it's Acts 12. He's murdered. John lives much longer, is imprisoned much more often, is persecuted much more often. And like church history tells us, like he's eventually exiled like to this island, but like he suffers like almost all the days of his life being persecuted. So Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those whom it has been prepared. So Jesus speaking to these men, they come to him and they say, we want to sit at your right hand and at your left. And in their mind, they're like associating this idea of like receiving the greatness of Jesus. Not as great, but just right there a little under. And that's kind of what they're wanting. And Jesus says, okay, you don't really understand what that means because you don't really understand what greatness is. And it's not mine to give who will be at the right or at the left. I think really what he's saying is that like the Father has prepared a certain way in which it's not just Jesus that, yeah, you can do it and you can do it. There's a way in which you ought to live that opens up greatness in the kingdom. That way is set, it's established. Jesus isn't coming and just handing it out to his best friends. Like Jesus says, there is a way you're gonna have to live. There's a way you're gonna have to act if you want to be the right hand and the left hand man of Jesus. If you wanna sit by him, if you wanna receive greatness, if you wanna be glorified with Jesus, there is a certain way you have to live. There's a certain way you have to act. And he goes on and says, when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And so it's kind of like, okay, we've been focusing on James and John because they're asking for it. The others aren't like saying, oh, they shouldn't ask that. Like they're kind of upset because, well, they want to be the right hand and the left. Like why just them two? Like us, like they kind of all want greatness. So what Jesus is going to do is he's going to gather them together. It's a teaching moment. And the teacher's going to teach. Jesus called them to him and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Highlighted the word Gentiles. The word Gentiles comes from a Greek word ethnos, and it's where we get our word ethnic. It's a word that just basically means like the different nations. Sometimes it's translated that way, the nations. Like that's what he's saying. Like don't get confused by the word gent. Like it's just saying, okay, you look at the world and you see all these different nations. And you look at the great people and the kings, the rulers of the nations. What do? They lord it over people. If you're powerful, you exercise your power. Rome was in power. I don't know how many dishes the Caesar washed in his life, but I wouldn't imagine it was many, right? I mean, he's probably never washed a dish in his life. I don't know how many times he swept the floor. I don't know how many, any of his chariots he personally drove himself. Like the idea is like the greater you become, the less you do. The more people do for you. You become rich and powerful, you become great, and all of a sudden, you just sit there and people just do for you. All right? You want your clothes, someone else is laying out. Sometimes they would even have other people dress them. They would serve their food, they would prepare it and bring it to them. They just got to enjoy eating it. And then once they were done eating it, somebody else would take it, and they would take it away, and they'd wash it, and they never have to worry about the other things that they don't want to do. I mean, we all like to eat, but like we don't usually like to prepare and clean and then they just enjoy the eating process. And then someone else took it away. When they went from one place to another, they would sit while someone else drove them or carried them at times. Why? Because they can. Because those in power have the right to exercise authority, to say, do this, and other people do it. And like we get this like grandiose idea of what does it mean to be great, and like what do I want and what do I aspire to? And like so many times like people think, I want to be great. Like I want to have somebody else like have to serve me at all times. Like kings were known. Like how wealthy and how powerful of a king? Well, how many servants did they have? Like, this is what greatness is. Like in the world's mind. Like how many people serve me? And not just like, we're talking about like food and like clothing, like how many people will go fight the battles that I want them to fight? This nation over here is not making me happy. I want to conquer them. I'm going to rally up my people. They're going to risk their lives. They're going to go out there and fight them. They might live, they might die, but they're going to do what I tell them to do. They're going to fight my cause. They're going to fight my battles. They're going to do what I say. Live, die, doesn't matter to me. They are going to do what I tell them to do because I am powerful, because I am king, because I am, and they will serve me. That's the idea that many have of greatness. It's the way the nations work. Jesus says, but it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. You want to be great among somebody, serve them. Like Jesus and his concept of greatness and the kingdom is just flipped upside down from the nations. The nations say greatness is when people serve you. Jesus' greatness is when you serve somebody else. That's what greatness is. It's being a servant. It's doing for others. The word translated as servant is a word in which we often get like the word deacon from. Like it's the idea of like ministering to somebody or looking out for what needs to be done and doing it. Does somebody need help in something? Well, a great person will go help them. Does somebody hurt? A great person will go and try to ease that pain. Is somebody hungry? A great person will feed them. Is somebody cold? A great person will clothe them. Greatness is looking to see what do others need and serving them. He goes on, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. Like if you want to be like first or primary, preeminent, don't think about people being your slaves. You think of yourself as being a slave to them. It's like it's completely opposite. And so Jesus is asking, okay, can you drink the cup that I drink? Can you be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? Because Jesus, as he sat on his throne, wasn't sitting there for people to serve him. He actually served. Can you do that? How much can you do that? Consider your life. How many people do things for you? And how many people do you do things for? How upset do you get when somebody doesn't do things the way you want them to be done? And how concerned are you with doing things the way somebody else wants things done? If something needs to be done, do you wait for somebody to do it, getting upset if it's not done? Or do you say, I need to serve? I need to put myself out. I need to make myself uncomfortable. I need to consider myself not the one who needs to have things done for, but the one who needs to do things for others. And ultimately, the reason we are that way, for the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So we're going to look at some passages that talk about why did Jesus come. If you want to know who Jesus is, know this. He did not come to be served. He came to serve. He came as a king to show you what greatness is. He wants to change your mind and my mind in the way we think and comprehend about the kingdom of God. He wants to change our minds in the way we think about what it means to be great and what it means to be primary and what it means to be first among the people. What is it that God says is great? Jesus says, that's why I came. I want to show you. And so what I did is I came to serve. I came to look out for the needs of other people. What do they need? And so like you read through Jesus' life. And of course, like he was able to do things that we weren't and are not able to do. He would see a blind person. Now he knew that healing that blind people was gonna get a lot of people upset at him. And as a matter of fact, it might lead to him being mistreated. It might lead to him being killed. It might lead to a bunch of other things, but he saw somebody who was blind, who needed help, and he helped them. Why? Because that's why he came. He saw someone lame. He saw someone hungry. He saw the poor. He saw the needy. He saw people who were outcasts and mistreated, and he came not so that he could look at the people weaker than them, than him, and say, hey, you serve me, but he came as the most powerful being that has ever stepped foot on this earth, and he bent down, and he washed feet, and he fed, and he clothed, and he healed, and he cared for, and like he looked, and he said, what do they need? And he served. Why? Because he's great. The greatest that has ever lived. And if you want to be great, you'll be like him. Jesus did not imagine the Son of God, the Son of Man, this picture that is drawn, I mentioned it earlier from Daniel chapter 7, of this king, this man, like God-man mixture kind of like being that the world has never seen. And you would imagine just from like your vision of what would take place on the earth that he would come to this world and he would live in this giant mansion or castle and people would serve him night and day, bringing him food and drink and all that he needs. And yet he came to a poor family in a poor village amongst a poor nation. And he spent his life saying, what do you need? And ultimately, so much did he serve others. So much did he see what others needed that he gave his life as a ransom for many. Interesting word. The word translated is ransom here. I don't know if you remember. I hesitate to even bring this up because the lesson was, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks ago now. And if you're like me, you've probably forgot it. But in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, there's an interesting word that's translated as worship. Right? So the passage says, Paul says, I beseech you therefore, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable form of worship or reasonable service. But that word worship or service, we said, it's kind of a hard word to translate because there's part of it that like relates back to the Old Testament. And like what they would do is they would take these animals and they would bring them and they would sacrifice them. And it was part of their worship. It was also something offered or served. And it was this word latreo, right? To serve or to worship. And it has to do with like animal sacrifices. And what Paul was saying in Romans is that you present yourself like that. You serve, you offer yourself as a living sacrifice. You see yourself as the lamb that's slaughtered for like for others. Like that's the idea, is like you serve the Lord with everything. Interesting, and we've talked about this before. You know, Jesus isn't gonna ask you to do that if he's unwilling to do that. This word ransom is translated from the same word. He gave his life as like that sacrificial offering, that sacrifice, the ransom, right? That he served others, and what he saw in others was a need, not just for food and shelter and clothing, not just for the ability to see, the ability to walk, and the ability to not be sick. And like he healed a lot of people of a lot of infirmities. But he saw something greater that you had a need of. And the others, he might be able to heal you by saying, rise up and walk. But to heal you from this, he had to be like that lamb that was slaughtered. And he was great enough to present himself that way, to give his life as a ransom for many, because he saw the need. Why did Jesus come? Well, we'll see more as we study over the next couple of weeks. But know this, when Jesus came, we like the picture of him, laying in a manger and all those different things. He was always born into this world so that he could serve other people, could teach us how to serve, he could show us what greatness is, ultimately serving by giving his life as ransom for many, as a sacrifice, as a lamb that is slaughtered for our sins. And that's why he came. Never forget that. That's why Jesus was born into this world. That's why the angels sang when he was brought into this world. It's why the wise men came and offered gifts. All the different things that people will talk about throughout this season. Remember this, it was all done so he could serve, teach us how to serve, teach us about greatness, and so that he could give his life for us because we needed him to. If there's anyone in here this morning who is not yet a Christian, we would love to help you in any way that we can become one. If we can study more about Jesus with you, we would love to do that. If we can pray for you, we would love to pray for you. If there's anyone in here this morning who needs to be baptized, we would love to help you with that as well. If there's something we can do to help you in your walk with God, we give you this opportunity to sit on one of the front rows while we stand and sing the song of invitation.
Calling to day, Jesus is the same.
closing song this morning will be number 745. We'll sing the first and last verse.
Heavenly Father, the high and most holy God, you are the greatest, most powerful. You are the creator of all that we love and all that we know. You present your will in our lives, and you show your strength in the very wind we feel today. Father, there are many here that were mentioned before that need you. Pray for those. We pray for those who were not mentioned, the unknown. We pray for the lost. And in this time of giving and receiving gifts, when we're out buying for our loved ones, our friends and co-workers, we pray that we will offer the gift that you've given us to them, the gift of your Son, the gift that you've given us. We pray that they will receive it. And those who are lost will be found. Father, we pray for those who serve us in the military, who keep us safe, give us the right, the ability to praise you. We pray for our first responders who deal with horrors that we can never foresee, that you will give them peace. Father, we have all sinned, and we pray that you will forgive us of our sins and you will forgive those who have sinned against us. But let us never forget the love you've given us and the gift of everlasting hope, of everlasting life with you. Of course, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.